guys. You know, you talk about Garrett and TCU. I think people forget they just got there. You know, when Alex was talking about in year two, that's year one. I mean, how impressive the year they've had. And then Alex, the year that they had, and I'm so bullshit that Tennessee hired him and their staff because they're in our division, and hopefully him leaving will kick a leg out from how they are offensively. But what a great job they did, and he's right. Hendon Hooker had an unbelievable year, and I'm just so happy for him and Alexis and getting the South Florida job. You're going to kill it. You're going to absolutely kill it. And then Ryan Walters, I grew up in Illinois, and he says, I said, Illinois was my dream school. I mean, when I was a kid, man, my dad was a high school coach. His players went there. And to see what they've done there defensively and just, and that's the reason. I mean, they're killing it. And we went against him when he was at Missouri, my first year at Georgia, and they were hard to prepare for. Their kids played the rear ends off, and they challenged you. And then Jesse, who, showing my age, I was a graduate assistant for his dad, Rick Minner, and Rick was way ahead of his time. I said this last night to whoever's there. You talk about a guy, analytics these days, he was on the forefront of that in terms of defenses versus formations, in terms of how you scheme people. And then he went to Cincinnati, and he wanted Cincinnati when nobody wanted Cincinnati, when no one wanted to be at Cincinnati. Not like now where Brian Kelly and Butch Jones and other guys, when nobody won. And he was awesome to me and treated me like gold. You know, a year ago, I heard a coach make a statement of some people think they've hit a triple, and yet they basically just landed on third base. And I thought about that for a second. And I thought, you know, that's not always a bad thing. You know, I was fortunate enough to be raised by two awesome parents. My dad was a coach. My mom was a second grade teacher. Two brothers, they're in coaching. And I landed on third base. Not everybody gets that opportunity. Not everybody is lucky enough and fortunate enough to be in a loving home. Two parents still together. And I did. I landed on third base. And then a few years later, my wife, Terry, had been married 31 years. She decided that she felt sorry for me, so she agreed to marry me. And I landed on third base. And I didn't hit the triple. And you can only imagine with us and our coaches' wives what they have to go through. My son, through his grade, when he was born, through the time he left for college, we moved 8 times. And your wife is the one that keeps it together. And I appreciate that. And then a chance to come to Georgia, I landed on third base. I wasn't like TCU, wasn't like at Knoxville. I came into a culture that was already established and really good players. And all we had to do was fight like hell to make it better. And that doesn't mean my whole career I've landed on third base, for God's sakes. I've worked my ass off, okay? Let's at least be honest here. But I am very appreciative of opportunities that I've gotten. And one thing about it is I'm just a byproduct of our players, Kirby Smart and the culture, and our coaching staff. And I've been doing this a long time and been around a lot of great coaches, and my whole family's in coaching. And there's nobody I trust more than Kirby Smart in terms of we're gonna win, we're gonna work, we're gonna recruit. And that's over 56 years. And I want to thank our staff. And, you know, when we played the other day, I always have believed this, that I see an offensive staff as like a rock band or a group, that you need every piece of it, that you take the collective strength of the staff and give them pieces of it, and then you just coordinate it as best you can. Because it takes everybody. It takes songwriters. It takes the musicians. And they're the ones that make it come to life. The first two touchdown passes we threw the other day, those were Mike Bobo's ideas. Those weren't mine. The third touchdown pass was Ryan Williams, an analyst. It wasn't my idea. Someone else's idea. We just fought like hell during the week to see if we could make it right. So very, very lucky in that regard. I do want to end with a few stories that along the way, one thing about being old is you have a bunch of stories of what made me as an assistant coach. So my first job was at Grand Valley State University for Tom Beck. I was a coach's kid, thought I knew it all. Tom asked me, back in those days, you had a bulletin board because you didn't have graphics. You had to put the day's event on the bulletin board. You had to put rosters. You had to put the practice schedule. You put whatever. Well, he gave me Sports Illustrated, and he asked me to cut out football pictures and put them in the corners and make the bulletin board look really nice. Well, I thought, well, this is a really bullshit job for a big-time guy like me. So, as you can imagine, I did it, and the next day I walked in, and Tom Beck grabs me, and he says, Todd, I want you to look at that bulletin board. And I looked at it, and he's like, you're right, it looks like shit, and your name's written all over it. And he's right. Whatever you do, it's a job interview, and your name's written on it. That was a reflection of me. All right, end up being lucky enough to go work for Coach Holtz at Notre Dame as a grad assistant, and for Coach Minner. One Sunday after we played, all the coaches want lunch. I said, you know what, I'm gonna cheese up to the head coach and go see if he wants lunch. So I go in there, I said, Coach, I'm going to Wendy's. Would you like something for lunch? He said, Todd, your ass is right. I want a chicken sandwich and a chocolate chip cookie. So I go to Wendy's. I get there. I bring it back. I give him his bag. He looks in the bag, and he's digging around. And when you're Lou Holtz, you're used to getting your way. All right? He's like, Todd, where's my chocolate chip cookie? I said, well, Coach, they were out. He said, you mean the whole city? And he was right. He didn't ask for a chocolate chip cookie from that Wendy's. He asked from, so from then on, I brought the sumbitch six, all right? So, you know, at that point, he was going to get a bunch of cookies, I can promise you that. All right? And then my last story, working for Les Miles. Obviously, if you're Arkansas fans, you know that rivalry game. And Les was from the Bo Schembechler era. He loved to practice. I mean, he loved to practice. Like, it was 3 hours, 20-minute walkthrough, 28 minutes of inside run. He thought fourth and four was toss it to Jacob Hester, neck rolls, pop pipe. I mean, this was long, okay? And he was again, I wouldn't be where I'm at, but Les had a way where the players felt like we just worked too hard. And what I learned then, and I already knew it, is so important for assistant coaches. And that is, your number one job is to carry the message from the big room to the little room to your players. Whether you completely would do it that way or not, I didn't believe we needed 28 minutes of inside run. I didn't believe we needed to practice 3 hours. But you know what I did? I went in that room and I said, guys, we're going to be tougher than who we play. We're going to be better in the fourth quarter. We're going to kick their ass when it matters. Because if you don't, and you roll your eyes like, I don't know why we're practicing as long, your players won't believe in the direction you're headed. Your job as an assistant is to carry the message of the head coach from the big room to the little room, and that's how you're successful. I appreciate it. Thank you very much. I'm honored to be here with these great coaches and the guys before me, and go Dawgs.